Good afternoon, everyone. Ritu, congratulations to you. And as we usually said in Google, I could just say a plus one, which is to mean that I agree with everything that you said. So thanks for laying that foundation. It's an absolute honor to be here this afternoon amidst a very distinguished gathering. And I would remiss in my duty if I do not pay my salutations to all the teachers out there. So Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Thank you all for everything you do to touch lives. Firstly, I accept this honor and recognition with a deep sense of humility and gratitude to everyone who's touched my life and has played a role in my journey and my development. I was asked to share my journey since I graduated from TAPME back in 99, that's 20 years. And as I thought about what I could share that you might not already go find in various social platforms, I thought of what I call a full circle story that I thought was very interesting, a full circle story at and with TAPME. So here I go. Now, before I start the story, there is a quote by Winston Churchill that I deeply appreciate, and the quote goes like this: success is not final, failure is not fatal, it's the courage to continue that counts. The quote aptly contextualizes what I'm about to share with you. Circa 1998, we came back to the campus from our summers to the news that the campus had decided to scrap the HR specialization owing to some faculty movements. Big news came from came like a bolt from the blue. Now, we started kind of standing our ground and started arguing with the management. A lot of us had quit our jobs, raised loans, and decided to pursue a dream. I, for one, definitely wanted to specialize in HR. Professor Nagabrahmam, who was the director of the institute at that point in time, came and spoke to us, but the stalemate continued for a couple of weeks, and then he finally said it's his responsibility to bring good faculty to help us complete our course and graduate as HR professionals. And he also made a promise that he himself would teach us all the subjects every weekend. Now, as they say, everything happens for a reason. Professor Brahmam is one of the best OB faculty you could ever find. So as we were waiting for the faculty to come in, and they did, you know, he kept his promise, he was also teaching us every single weekend, bringing in all the wisdom, all the knowledge, and all the experiences that he had. He was a great follower of the people practices at Infosys, and that's another coming full circle. A year later, I was actually hired by Infosys on campus. Okay? So there are a lot of dots that gets connected. Now, staying course with the story, I'll share with you what I did in a little bit, but staying course with the story. 20 years later, 2018, I got a call from the director of the institute, this time Professor Madhavir Raghavan, inviting me to be on the advisory board for a PGDM HR program as TAPME was launching. Right? It's a one-of-its-kind program, a first-of-its-kind program in partnership with SHRM. So from a student fighting to keep a course alive, fighting to display a voice, exhibit a voice, to being invited to shape the journey of a program, the same HR program, 20 years difference. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a slice of my journey since I graduated from TAPME. Now, in these 20 odd years, I worked with two great institutions, Google and Infosys, not necessarily in that order. It helped me shape my values, shape my principles as a professional, as a leader. It gave me the courage and conviction to go and start an entrepreneurial venture, which I can swear in front of everybody, I did not believe I had it in me. Set up Noetic Step in Singapore, an executive coaching and a talent advisory practice. And as I was sharing with someone, I was living a dream. It was a year, and then life does offer curveballs. And there was one in my life as well. Singapore government tapped me on the shoulder for what could be a very unique and a very exciting opportunity to play a small part in nation building. So 2 weeks ago, I debuted in public service And I've joined GovTech, Government Technology Agency, to oversee their corporate strategy, human resources, and organizational development. Now, what did I really do in these 20 years? I'd like to believe that what I did was I set up organizations and teams, built and scaled them in country, in region, globally. I nurtured and created cultures and careers, led large transformations, but most importantly, love my life, coached several leaders and professionals. Am I grateful for that? Absolutely, more than. I couldn't have asked for anything more. Now, there are several people that I need to thank as well, especially every single mentor of mine, every single manager that I work with, every single team person, team member that I've ever worked with, all the well-wishers, and all the naysayers as well. They doubted. I mean, there was a lot that I saw when I was starting off on my own. I'm happy for them in my life as well. And in the context of TAPME, there are three people that I'd like to thank. Professor Brahmam, who I mentioned off earlier. Professor Sunil Parameshwaran, who was our placement chair, so I owe my first job to him. And there's a long story that I wouldn't narrate today in the paucity of time. And thirdly, Professor Simon George, who was the faculty advisor of TAPME's largest co-curricular event on the calendar called Brand Scan, because I was the convener for Brand Scan. And I learned as much in that 1 year being a convener as much as I did inside the classroom. Now, finally, a few thoughts on what I believe could be the future of management education. Let me start with the question. What if we are faced with a situation where management education has become as obsolete as a typewriter course became a few years ago? I'm not trying to be provocative here, or maybe I am, but I'm just putting forth the possibility of what could be a real situation because of the technology-led revolution that's happening and which is fundamentally changing the way we live and work. Think about the business models such as Uber, Ola, Big Basket, or Flipkart of the world. They're all addressing interesting challenges that had not been addressed or solved before. They're all bringing services and experiences to the doorstep of a user. How do we prepare our students for roles and organizations which are dynamic and disruptive? Now, you're all experts in management education. I'll be speaking to the choir if I start speaking about anything in management education. And I wanted to bring in a practitioner's perspective with my coach's hat on and share what I believe could be core attributes for a leader for tomorrow. And that is the operative word. We need to go beyond developing just managers and nurture future leaders who can not only deal with complex problem solving, but have the ability to envision a future, courage and perseverance to move towards it, and most importantly, take people with them. I believe, therefore, the leader has to have these three attributes. Start with values. We need to help our students discover what their true north is, or what values do they hold dear and can identify with, and most importantly, live with. It's these values that will ultimately decide their choices when they are in an ambiguous situation. Think about it like the Wimbledon finals that we just saw. Fifth set, 12 all, and there's a tiebreaker. What would they pull out of? They go to their values. Now, respect, fairness, and humility have been the three values that I have always stood by, and it's become the core of the character that I show as a person and a leader, and every student will have to have theirs. Number two, empathy. Any amount of intellect and problem-solving skills will not compensate for the true humanness that we will need in today's world. We're living in the times when there are more time that's spent on social media and on phones, even sitting next to each other, than actually connecting and talking to people. Human-less transactions and chatbots are becoming a norm. As Albert Einstein once said, our technology has exceeded our humanity. We need to instill a sense of compassion in our students, which is no longer a good to have, but necessary for keeping our humanity alive in the times of the technology revolutions. Three, learning agility. I refer to another favorite quote of mine. Author Alvin Toffler wrote that the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. To manage ambiguity, we need to instill in our students a mindset and willingness to learn quickly and be able to connect the various differences from their past to solve for the future problems. It also means that they need to constantly stay relevant with awareness. One cannot be an expert in everything, but awareness of the new trends, technologies, law and compliances, and industry paradigms. Perhaps most importantly, we can play a role in helping them learn to be comfortable with the uncomfortable. Now, while everything that I've shared so far will undoubtedly create a holistic, future-ready leader, our biggest success as educators will be when these leaders show passion and are passionate to create an impact in making a world a better place, be it in business, environment, or society. Again, huge thank you for the honor today and the opportunity to share a few thoughts with all of you. Thank you.